Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, Dr. Yogesh, for that kind introduction. At the outset, I would like to thank Dr. Anita Kale Chalak, madam, for giving me this opportunity to speak on a topic which is quite close to my heart, on NABL accreditation. I also compliment Dr. Anita Kale Chalak, madam, and her entire team for organizing such a wonderful CME, completely on quality, giving a hands-on experience on various aspects of quality. And I'm sure it's a way forward for developing quality in the country. So congratulations, madam, and the entire team. And with this, I will move on to my topic of NABL accreditation. Now, this is going to be a long journey and this is going to be a long session of 1.5 hours. So I know I'll go a bit slow. And speaking about accreditation, it's not something which can be, they can say, digested, earned or learned in a matter of 1 or 1.5 hours. It's a long, long journey. But my point over here is that the audience which I'm addressing to must be a mixed crowd. Many of them must be from NABL accredited labs. Some could be in a different positions like quality manager, lab directors. Some could be in the process of start going for NABL accreditation. And there could be some who might be completely, you can say, ignorant or apprehensive about accreditation, what it is. So my job is here to touch upon various aspects of NABL accreditation, the entire journey, you can say, and just sensitize you on how to start this journey to reach that goal. So we all in our respective laboratories strive hard to maintain higher standards of our lab results. But they come within the available resources in terms of manpower, equipment, reagents. Those resources are always a crunch at our end. But at the end of the day, we produce a lab report or result, and we all feel that our lab results are the best. However you do, I take my own example when I was not knowing ABCD of quality, and when I was handling a lab at Sion Hospital, and I was saying everything that we do is absolutely fine. And yes, that's inner confidence that we have. So in short, we certify our own work. We say that what we do is the best and it cannot be challenged, and we certify our own work. So let us try to understand what types of certifications are there. And we basically categorize into three types of certification. The example which I gave you right away is first party certification. Lab belongs to the user who is satisfied. The lab belongs to me. I'm satisfied. I certify. So that's a first party certification. It has lot many lacunes in it. So we move on to the second level of certification. We call it a second party certification, wherein the lab does not belong to the user, but user using its own means certify the laboratory. Dr. Yogesh Pawde is a good friend of mine. Dr. Anita Kale is a good friend of mine. I just invite them, okay, come and go through my lab, and I have a nice breakfast, lunch with them, and we both speak very goody-goody about each other. And it's certified. They certified your lab is doing absolutely fine. So that's the second party certification. Again, not complete by itself. We move on to the third party certification, wherein it is a certifying or accreditation body, which is neither the owner nor the person appointed by the owner, which comes and goes through the entire process of accreditation. And this third party accreditation is the formal accreditation procedure by which an authoritative body gives formal recognition that a body or person, here we will use the word laboratory, that laboratory is competent to carry out specific tasks. Very, very clear cut definition. Procedure by which an authoritative body, this authoritative body in India is NABL, which gives us formal recognition that the laboratory is competent to carry out specific tasks. It will not give you accreditation for everything under the banner that you do. Only whatever is specified in the scope only under for those specific tasks it will give you the accreditation. The full form of NABL, we all speak about it, but it's very difficult to remember. It's National Accreditation Board for Testing and Calibration Laboratories. Basically deals with testing and calibration laboratories. Now, what is this NABL? Is it a government organization? Is it a statutory? Is it a private organization? Does it have any national, international, regional connections, and so on and so forth? So NABL works directly under Asia Pacific Laboratory Accreditation Cooperation. And Asia Pacific Laboratory Accreditation Cooperation works under International Laboratory Accreditation Cooperation. So if you see the organogram, it starts right from International Laboratory Accreditation Cooperation. Under ILAC, there are various regional accreditation organizations. For us, it is APLAC, Asia Pacific Laboratory Accreditation Cooperation. It has mutual recognition agreement, which are valid for 4 years. So like NABL comes and visit the laboratories and to see and certify an accreditation status. Similarly, NABL by itself is being audited by APLAC, the Asia Pacific Laboratory Accreditation Corporation. And APLAC is audited by ILAC, International Laboratory Accreditation Corporation. So it's this very stringent chain, which starts from the topmost body of ILAC, then moves on to the regional ones, APLAC, and then many more worldwide. And then whatever laboratories come under APLAC in India, which are come under NABL, NABL is audited by APLAC. The process of accreditation in India was started way back in 1981. Unfortunately, medical laboratories were really slow to get into the process of accreditation. But of late, it has been picking up, and it is picking up very, very rapidly. And till date, like as on 30th June 2021 is common. The 2,139 medical laboratories are accredited as on today. And maybe another 100 to 200 must be in the pipeline. The functions of NABL is to promote development and maintenance of good practice in testing and measuring, and to establish and maintain international recognition for its national accreditation programs. So as I said, NABL has an international recognition. It is a full member and maintain linkage with the ILAC and APLAC. And what is the global perspective? What we say? So this is the topmost organization, International Laboratory Accreditation Corporation. Under this topmost organization, there are various accrediting zonal agencies, or you can say regional agencies worldwide. APLAC stands for Asia Pacific Laboratory Accreditation Corporation. This is European Accreditation Corporation. This is International American Association Cooperation. That's another thing. This is Arab Accreditation Cooperation. So there are multiple zone-wise worldwide accreditation bodies which come under ILAC, and under each one of them, either based on the continent or the region, there are various, like APLAC. APLAC has got NABL, which comes from India, COLAS, which comes from Korea. So the Asian companies come under this. Now, what is the beauty of this? Say, let us boil down to NABL and India, and then under NABL, and when we just restrict ourselves to medical laboratories, under NABL, there are N number of medical laboratories. So what is happening? This laboratory is going to produce a result. Similarly, there will be another laboratory under APLAC, under some another country. There are multiple laboratories. That laboratory will also produce a result. It can come from laboratory which is under European cooperation, American cooperation, Arab cooperation. At the end of the day, what it is said, the processes are so nicely and rigidly maintained that the result that is being produced by any laboratory which has been accredited by NABL and any other laboratory which is accredited by either one of them would be the same. So what your test result will have a global equivalence, and that's the biggest perspective of NABL accreditation. So what is the scope of Enable accreditation? Does it do only medical laboratories? No. Medical laboratory is a small component. It has a huge component of testing laboratories, testing in the field of chemical, biological, mechanical, electrical, electronics, and so on. It also accredits calibration laboratories, mechanical, electrotechnical, fluid, thermal, optical. So these calibration laboratories are accredited by NABL. It also accredits medical laboratories. Under medical laboratory, what all disciplines it accredits, it's in the next slide. But apart from medical laboratory, just for your knowledge, NABL has recently started accreditation process for medical imaging, that is radiology, medical imaging, proficiency testing providers, and reference material producers. So it's a vast scope of NABL. Let us go, narrow ourselves to medical laboratories. In medical laboratory, NABL gives accreditation for so many disciplines. What are those disciplines? Clinical biochemistry. All your clinical chemistry assays, clinical chemistry, immunoassays, chemical markers, tumor markers. Everything is under clinical biochemistry. Clinical pathology is examination of urine and stool will be under clinical pathology. Hematology is all your CBC. Microbiology and infectious disease serology. Micro is a big one. Either your fungal cultures, your bacterial cultures. So all culture and sensitivity under microbiology. And infectious disease serology are numerous markers like HIV, HBsAg, SCV, immunoglobulinase, IgG, IgM, IgG, and so many markers are there under infectious disease serology. There's a tremendous scope under histopathology, cytopathology, flow cytometry, cytogenetics, and recently, with COVID in place, lot emphasis or mini laboratories have come up with for molecular testing. So these are the 9 disciplines under which NABL gives accreditation to medical laboratories. Now, going for NABL accreditation is not an easy task. So before you want to go for NABL accreditation, one has to see what are the general benefits. So I have put them into 2. What are the general benefits of accreditation? And in the next slide, you will see what are the benefits for a medical laboratory. So general benefits, as I said, it gives you international recognition. The lab is accredited irrespective of whether it is NABL, whether it is CONAS, whether any lab under European accreditation or American accreditation. Accreditation status is universal and it has a global equivalence. So it gives you international recognition. It gives access to global market because you are at par with the global requirement. It gives enhanced customer confidence and satisfaction. The systems are such that once you implement it, you are able to implement a robust quality management system. So automatically the controls that you require on day-to-day basis, in fact, over a period of time, you can even lessen the controls because systems get such in such a way that you really don't have to bother about the things. If anything goes wrong, it gets immediately captured. There is a scope for continual improvements. You have better operational control because the systems are in place. It gives you assurance of accurate and reliable results. And if you have everything, if you are doing it right, and right at the first time, then there's definitely going to be a tremendous decrease in cost. There's a cost reduction. You don't have to unnecessarily go for repeat calibrations, rechecks, and something like that. And it prevents loss due to defects because defects get immediately captured and corrective actions are taken. So these are the general benefits of accreditation. As a lab per se, medical laboratory, what are the benefits? Number one, it's a ready means for customers. Anybody who wants to get tested, now there is a lot of public awareness has come. So if I want to get tested, I want to know a laboratory. So to identify and select lab which is going to give me a reliable report, I don't have to hunt around or ask for someone. I just have to see which lab is NABL accredited, and that's it. So ready means for customers. Increase confidence in reports. So once you get both for the laboratory which issues the report and for the customer who gets the report, there is increased confidence. Be assured that the report that you have got is the most reliable report. Extensively accepted by regulators. Now all insurance companies, Mediclaim and all those things, they ask, oh, we want a laboratory report, we want an NABL accredited laboratory report. All clinical trials, they want a report, they want a report from an accredited laboratory. So extensively accepted by regulators for the public benefit. It gives you better control on lab operations. And yes, as a laboratory, you can participate in various government or private tenders, because it's become difficult for a private or a government to identify a laboratory, because many laboratories will come out with the same specification. If you would, the government want 20 tests to be done, there will be hundreds of labs who will be able to do 20 tests. How the government or private sector will be able to determine which is better or which is able to maintain the quality? So one simple is that if you are NABL accredited, you can participate. So it the government agency or the private agency really do not have to go through your other documents of quality management system or quality control data and so on. One certification is more than sufficient. So all this gives a potential increase in business due to enhanced customer confidence and satisfaction. Not only business, but it gives you a tremendous sense of satisfaction and relief that everything that is going on in your laboratory is absolutely going in the correct way. This is all for the laboratory, for the users of the laboratory, for people working in the laboratory. But what about the staff who is working in a NABL accredited lab? Please remember, better career prospects to accredited lab staff. If I am working whatever designation in an accredited laboratory, and if I want to switch over, I'm sure that if there is a competitor who has is not working in an accredited laboratory, I would be chosen because I know the systems much, much better and I already learned them, implemented them. So it gives you better career prospects. Now, having known the advantages, what is NABL? Now let us move a step forward, and if you want to get your lab NABL accredited, what needs to be done? Now, for many, there will be n number of questions coming on up your mind. How should I start? I want to get my lab accredited. What should I do? How should I start? What is the resource material? From where I'll get some material which I must read and then start implementing? What are the various prerequisites for applying to NABL? Who can guide me on this? What are the documentation requirements? How do I create all necessary documents? Do I really need somebody to help me, guide me, some agency who will help me out with all documentation? Can anyone do this for me? And then, if you are patient enough, then you will go with this, or else, oh God, just leave it. I may not be able to achieve it. I'm happy with the way my lab is moving ahead. So it's almost like a blank slate, and you have to move from this blank slate. You have to break this shell. You have to adopt certain things to get that status of NABL accreditation. And to achieve this, I will try to unfold what should be the process or what should be the approach. So how should I start? You basically require to have and understood two most important documents. One is ISO 15189-2012 standards. Now, this document is for the medical laboratories requirement for quality and competence. You can call this to be a Bible of medical laboratory academy. From where do you get this document? You will get it from Bureau of Indian Standards. You can just mail them your requirement and what is the price? within India, it is 770. Outside India, one more zero is added, 7,700. So soft copy is very easily available at 770 rupees. And please remember, it is a mandatory requirement for any laboratory going for accreditation or who is having accreditation that they should have a original copy of ISO 15189-2012 standards. This is one document. The second document, which I will come to it eventually, is NABL 112 document, which is freely available on NABL website. Now, what is this ISO 15189-2012 standards? As I said, this standard is for medical laboratories, requirements for quality and competence. What are the various requirements for achieving quality as well as competence? These two things have to go hand in hand. And this document is basically indexed into five subtopics. The scope of the document, the various references the document has used, various terminologies the document has used, and the 4 and 5 number are management requirements and technical requirements. This is the crux. These are the most important requirements which are needed to be followed by the laboratory. The management requirement, as we call it as clause number 4, it is subdivided into 15 sub-clauses, 4.1 to 4.50, and technical requirement has got 10 sub-clauses, 5.1 to 5.10. So in all, we have 25 sub-clauses which need to be addressed. The reason I say that there is a global equivalence, whatever is done in a laboratory, in even at a taluka place or any other place in India, and the test which is done in the most advanced European or an American country is or in America or US is going to be the same. For a simple reason is, if and throughout the globe this standard is followed, and if you are going to follow this standard in toto, then there cannot be any reason why there could be any deviation of your end results. So let us try to understand what are those requirements, management requirements, and please, this entire clause of 4.1 to 4.15 is taken in internal auditor's training for one complete day, and clause 5 is taken for one complete day. Now, to cut it short and get it into this lecture is a difficult task, but anyway, what I will do, I'll just try to highlight what each clause says. Again, 4.1 to 4.15 are management requirements. Many of us are technically associated with the laboratory. Many of us are not a part of management. So we try to neglect those things, or we are not connected with those areas of quality management system. But it is good to know what is being covered in that. And I'm sure the technical components, the clause 5, will be easy to understand because you deal with them day in and day out. The first sub-clause is organization and management responsibility. What is the responsibility of the organization and the stakeholders of the organization, that is the management? So what is the responsibility? This clause covers certain things. Number one, under this clause, each lab should be legally identified. So you should have your own legal entity, either a shop and establishment act or some other license, or if you're registered under clinical establishment act. So there should be some license, some proof that this is your legal identity. Second important component in this is the lab should have a procedure so that ethical conduct is maintained by the laboratory. No laboratory can function bypassing the ethical requirements. So ethical conduct is also very, very important. This clause also demands that each laboratory should be directed by a laboratory director. The laboratory director's minimum required experience is given in MEBL 112. But this person has the vicarious responsibility of the laboratory. He is responsible for all end-to-end functions. Although he may have n number of deputies under him, depending on the size and the complexity of the laboratory. But if anything goes wrong, the lab director is the ultimate person who becomes responsible for it. This clause also demands that each laboratory should have a quality manager who is going to monitor the day-to-day quality management system affairs of the laboratory. I just want to tell you, there is many a times people feel that quality manager is one who manages the quality or who manages the internal and external quality control of the laboratory. Please don't have that impression with respect to NABL. As far as NABL is concerned, quality manager is a person who is going to implement and monitor the quality management system in the laboratory. And what the entire quality management system is, entire clause 4 is quality management system, and quality manager is responsible for entire clause 4. Although I said that clause 4 is full quality management system, it is covered separately under clause 4.2, and clause 4.2 gives how your quality management system has to be there. And what is quality management system in a nutshell? When I repeat this word again and again, what do you understand by the quality management system? So it is a process wherein you identify all different activities that are going in your laboratory. Right from pre-analytical, analytical to post-analyticals, you have to identify all the processes. And once you identify all the processes, then you have to identify their sequence and their interaction, and then you have to have a continuous monitoring on it. As we move ahead, things will be more clear. Next is documentation requirement or document control. Now, what's a document control? Just to go back, the quality management system also deals with your quality manual and the scope of the laboratory. Clause 3 deals with document control. Now, what's a document control? I'll be discussing a bit about it a bit later. But document control means, as a laboratory, you have n number of documents with you. You have your quality manual, your quality system procedures, you have your SOPs, you have various worksheets, and so on and so forth. Everything, each and every document the laboratory possesses, it should have a lab identity, unique ID number, and if there are versions or if that document is going to change, then it should have a specific version number, date when the new version has come into place, those amendments. So what I mean to say in a nutshell, document control is one. You have to have entire control on all the documents that exist in the laboratory. Next sub clause is service agreements. Service agreements, many of them service agreements are taken into consideration, service agreements done with some companies or something like that. Here, service agreement, the most important service agreement for a laboratory is with its client, with its customer, or with its patient. So the agreement between the patient and the laboratory, no patient comes to the laboratory, no laboratory asks him to sign a service agreement, but the test requisition form or a lab requisition form itself is taken as a service agreement between the patient and the laboratory. So that's the service agreement. Then next clause is examination by referral laboratories and consultants. Now, many a times what happens, whenever you are doing something in the laboratory, there could be a situation that your instrument become malfunction and you have to send samples to some other laboratory. or there is an histopathologist specimen, you have a junior pathologist with you, the pathologist has reported, but pathologist is not sure about the diagnosis and you want a second opinion. So you want to refer it to some other consultant. So this clause deals with both examination by referral laboratories as well as examination by consultants. So what is required? Each laboratory should have a memorandum of understanding with a referral laboratory or with a referral consultant. The terms and conditions should be very clearly mentioned in the MOU along with the duration of the MOU. So unless and you cannot see, you are an NABL accredited lab, you cannot refer your sample to any other lab which is not NABL accredited. So you have to have certain terms and conditions ki how you are going to select your referral laboratory. And if you select your referral laboratory, not only selection, you are going to periodically evaluate the performance of the referral laboratory or referral consultant. So that comes under clause 4.5. 4.6 deals with external services and supplies. As a laboratory, we are dependent on so many things. We are dependent on equipment, reagents, consumables, and so on, the IT solutions, and so on and so forth. So all these providers, they become your vendors. They are your vendors. And then lab should have a procedure for who would be my vendor, how would I categorize my vendor, what are my vendor selection criteria. And not only vendor selection criteria, once you have an approved vendor, you will have to monitor the performance of the vendor, whether the vendor is giving me right service, whether he is giving me the right product, whether he is giving me at the right price, whether he is giving me in the right stipulated time, what is the quality of the product which he supplies, whether he is able to maintain cold chain at his end. So there are n number of things which a vendor has to have for providing service to a laboratory. So the lab should have a procedure for selecting a vendor, and after selecting, for repeatedly evaluating that vendor over a period of time. And if that vendor is not able to give you service satisfactory, then lab should document the alternative method or what action the laboratory will take if their vendor is non-compliant. So everything about it comes under external services and supplies. Next is advisory services. Our job is not only to report. Many a times patients will ask, sir, my TSH has gone low, has gone high, or histopathology report is like this. And the questions are come to the laboratory. Or, okay, I had checked my blood glucose or HbA1c 3 months back, it was so and so, today it is so and so. So lab is responsible to provide the advisory services to the client. The advisory services could be in the form of giving clinical interpretation about the test result, guiding on additional tests to be performed, guiding on where it can be performed, guiding on what could be the false positives and false negatives with the test report. So all this comes as a part of advisory services, and lab should have competent staff to provide these advisory services. 4.8 is resolution of complaints. However good you perform, you are going to get some or the other complaints. And it is not something which should be annoying for the laboratory, because unless and until the laboratory understands what my end user is feeling about me or what are his problems or complaints, you are not going to improve. So whenever there are complaints, there should be a mechanism to address those complaints. A step ahead, there should not be only a mechanism to address the complaint, but there has to be a mechanism to take feedbacks as well as complaints. You should have a complaint box displayed. You should have a display board for any complaints, use this form or put up your direct your complaint to so and so. Use following modes for either you can put it on the lab portal, by an app, or by an email, or by a handwritten thing. There has to be a mechanism set up by the laboratory so that patients will, it becomes easy for patients to give complaints. And once you receive the complaints, there has to be a mechanism, internal mechanism of the laboratory to review what the complaint is, to address the complaint properly, and to ensure take appropriate corrective and prevention action so that the similar complaint do not recur in future. So that's resolution of complaints. Next, 3, you can say in the 4.9, 4.10, and 4.11, they all deal with non-conformities. Identification, 4.9 deal with identification and control of non-conformities, 4.10 is corrective action, and 4.11 is preventive action. Let us try to understand this. Non-conformities, people who are working in any well-accredited lab, they abbreviate it as NCs, and this is one thing which no one likes. So what's a non-conformity? Non-conformity is something, is nothing but a deviation from the normal. It's a simple. Non-conforming does not conform to the normal what has been documented. So whatever you have documented, if you are not conforming to that document, that becomes a non-conformance. Sometimes the non-conformances are very minor. Sometimes they are quite catastrophic. Many a time the non-conformances do not have any impact on the end result. But yes, there could be times that non-conformity could have an impact on end result. So it is the responsibility of the laboratory to have a procedure to identify the non-conformities, control these non-conformities, so the deviations, or you can say, I will not use the word error. Error will be there when there is a mistake, but there could be a deviation. It may not lead to an error, but there can be a deviation. I'll give you a simple example. Say, for example, it is mandatory that the person who is appointed to supervise daily quality control data has not reviewed the quality control data on a particular date. Now, your document says, your procedure says that all internal quality control data to be reviewed by the designated person, and after which patient samples are analyzed. Now, this middle stop thing got missed. IQC was run, patient sample were put into place, everything samples were run. Later we realized that the IQC data, the daily IQC data is not reviewed, you generate a non-conformance. Now this non-conformancy could have caused an error or may not cause an error. For a simple reason, if all IQCs are within the designated lab defined mean and SD, then there is no error and patient results are absolutely fine. So you have a non-conformity which has not created an error, but it could be other way around, that there are one or two deviations which are not got corrected, because of that results of one or two parameters might have got affected. So identifying, try to understand the word non-conformity. Non-conformity is only a deviation. Whatever documented procedure you have maintained, if you are not followed that documented procedure, then it becomes a non-conformity. All such non-conformities, whether it leads to a catastrophic impact or whether it leads to no impact, they need to be documented and they need to be controlled. Now, if it is going to cause an impact on the test result, then you have to take an appropriate corrective action. Again, we'll continue with the same example. Say, for example, both IQC for serum calcium are out of 3S. 1-3S violation in both, or in one or both, whatever. Now, once you note down this non-conformity, you have to take a corrective action. There's a difference between correction and corrective action. Correction means you rerun the sample, you get it, you do it, and the results are fine, you release them. But if it is happening repeatedly, daily your calcium is going out, daily you are rerunning the calcium, and on rerunning you are getting the correct value, and then you are releasing patient result, that's not the right. Correction and corrective action are different. Rerunning the QC value and you are getting the same is a correction, fine. But if the process is occurring repeatedly, then you will have to do a corrective action. Corrective action would be either recalibrate the system, check the calibration, or go into details. And if you don't want such thing to happen again and again, then lab should try to find out what is the preventive action. Why it is happening, you will have to go for the root cause analysis, find out exactly what has gone wrong, rectify it. Once rectified it, monitor whether after rectification you are getting the right results or not, and that becomes your preventive action. 4.12 is the continual improvement, and this is absolutely onus on the laboratory, and it is of the laboratory. It is up to each laboratory what continual improvement they want to achieve. Some will say that the continual improvement in my quality the controls, or continual improvement in quality indicators, continual improvement can be in terms of enhancement of scope of the laboratory, enhancing the discipline of the laboratory, could be training of the lab staff. So there could be multiple areas on which lab can think on and have a continual improvement. All what you do in the laboratory is going to generate data. That data will get captured in the form of records. And all these records, the lab should have a system to keep these records either in the physical format or in the digital format. And whenever you keep this record, there has to be a procedure for identification of such record, because over a period of time, you'll get huge records. So you should be able to identify the right record. You should be able to collect the record, index them properly, store them properly, and if you want to do any amendment, it has to be recorded properly. And yes, lab should have a procedure for safe disposal of records. You have patient record in the physical form or in the electronic form, and probably especially when you have it in the physical form, if you just want to destroy it away, you cannot give it to any Bhelpuri wala or somewhere where the identity of the patient to disclose. So there has to be a safe way of disposal of these records. 4.14 is a big clause, and that clause speaks about evaluation and audits. The lab should have an internal procedure to evaluate and audit its own systems and its day-to-day working. What all is required in evaluation and lab should periodically see whether our scope is able to satisfy customers' need or anything else to be increased. Are we correcting the right amount of sample that is required, or are a certain test just going out because the sample is insufficient quantity? So there has to be a periodic review of request and suitability of procedures and sample requirements. There should be assessment of user feedback. Most important, labs, apart from complaint, should have a procedure to take patient feedbacks. And not only taking patient feedback, there has to be a mechanism, a proper documented procedure to evaluate these feedbacks. Unless and until you evaluate these feedbacks, you will not come to know what are the gray areas. So that evaluation, who is going to evaluate, at what level evaluation is going to be there, what should be your, you will have to score each and every point under evaluation. What is the acceptance criteria of the score? What will you do if your scores fall down? How it is to be monitored? Everything needs to be documented. So that evaluation of user feedback is important. Lab should also take suggestions from staff. Staff is the, you can say, the biggest asset of the laboratory. And their feedback becomes very, very important. And their feedback need not be only for the benefit of the staff. Like many times staff feedback is that my salary has to be enhanced, the timings have to be altered, one more holiday has to be added. So those are different feedbacks or different suggestions. What are more important suggestions from the staff is suggestions with respect to quality management system of the laboratory. How can we give better patient services and what needs to be done on that? Those such suggestions should be taken from the staff and they should be evaluated. Lab should conduct internal audit at least once in a year of all the disciplines under its scope. So there has to be internal audit. With respect to internal audit, what all is required? Number one, the lab should have an internal audit plan. The lab should prepare an internal audit checklist. Lab should appoint an internal auditor. And please remember, while doing internal audit, one cannot audit his or her own area of work. Say, for example, a lab director who has the vicarious responsibility of the lab cannot audit any lab section because everything is under him. But yes, a pathologist can audit a biochemistry section, a biochemist can audit a pathology section or a microbiology section. That way you can do it. But if the lab has got only one pathologist as an authorized signatory, he cannot audit any section because he is responsible for all the area. You cannot audit your own area of work. So it has to be completely independent of your work. So lab has to carry out internal audit. Whenever there is an internal audit, there will be certain deviations which will be reported as non-conformances. Those non-conformances have to be resolved. Documentary evidence have to be attached, and those non-conformances have to be written as closed by the person who has carried out the audit. So that's one more important thing which comes under evaluation audit is risk management. This is absolutely a new clause, a new subset which has been put into ISO 15189/2012, and it is only three lines which have been here. The lab shall evaluate the impact of work processes and potential failures on examination result as they affect patient safety and shall modify the processes and so on. Now, risk management sounds a very, very simple clause, but please remember, it is one of the very complex clause. What does it help? I will explain you in a very simple way. Okay? Suppose I have to travel by my own car from Bombay to Pune. I think there is some background noise, please. Please mute. I'm hearing some background noise. Hello.
Health resource fundamentals, sir.
Hello, anybody from the organizing team? Yeah. Okay, so risk management, a simple example which I give you, I have to travel from Bombay to Pune in my own car. And if I say what could be the risk, so there I can identify multiple risks. There could be risk which my car, my tires can get punctured, I might get stuck up in the traffic. There not many things can happen. And once I understand what are the various risks, then I should probably try to find out if I want to mitigate these risks, what I should. Similarly, this is a very, very, you can say, a gross example, but similarly, if you want to practice, carry out risk assessment of a laboratory, then you should identify each and every process of the pre-analytical, analytical, and post-analytical processes of every discipline of your laboratory. Then you can have to find out at every stage what can all go wrong. If at all it's going to go wrong, what needs to be done, what preventive measures have to be taken into place so that such risks are not encountered. So risk management is something that you do before any failure occurs. You are just presuming that things may go wrong this way and you are taking preventive measures such so that those failures do not occur. So that's one of the very important sub-clause in risk of risk management. And the last but not the least, under clause 4 is management review or MRM. Now, MRM is once you do an internal audit, the lab has to conduct a management review meeting wherein it is expected that there has to be a management representative, there has to be lab director, the quality manager, one or two important technical key technical persons, your HR manager. So all key personals, including 2-3 people who are directly working on the ground as a technologist or accession team member, should be a part of management review meeting. And then there is a structured program of management review meeting, what all points to be discussed. And it is the completely bird's eye view which a management gets of the entire operations that are going in the laboratory. So if you see the what all comes under management review, so like whether your user feedback has been assessed or not, staff suggestions have been taken or not, internal audit conducted or not, what are the findings of internal audit, what are the findings of risk management, what quality indicator lab has been doing, how far it has moved ahead in the quality indicators, was there any review by NABN, what are the NCs by NABN, and so on and so forth. So friends, here we complete from 4.1 to 4.15. These are all management related. There's nothing technically into it, but yes, it forms a solid structure or solid framework on which your technical competence automatically excels. So we move on to the technical requirements, and which I'm sure you will feel it, find it quite easy to understand. Ten sub clauses, 5.1 to 5.10. The first one is personal. Yes, as I said, that is the biggest asset of the laboratory. I will put personnel as the biggest asset than that of high-end equipments or state-of-the-art equipments, because ultimately whatever you have, whether you have a good equipment or a not so good equipment, it is your quality of personnel who is going to work on it and produce a result. So lab should have a procedure for various, what all designation it has got, what qualification is required, what competence is required. Each personnel should have a job description very clearly assigned. There has to be a regular training of the lab staff. Their competency after the training, their competency has to be assessed, and they should undergo periodic, you can say they should be permitted to attend various CMEs and so on and so forth. So training and competency evaluation of lab personnel is the essence of this particular clause. This clause also addresses the safety of lab personnel, and it says that yes, this the staff has to get appropriately vaccinated. What all vaccines are required if you are going to work, even otherwise, whether you are working in NABL accredited lab or non-NABL accredited lab, each one of us should get vaccinated for tetanus, influenza, hepatitis B, and now COVID. So these four vaccines are compulsory. Earlier, the focus was only on hepatitis B and tetanus, but now there's been a shift. Apart from tetanus and hepatitis B, the staff should be vaccinated for influenza because of COVID and COVID-19 vaccine. So, and for hepatitis B, when the vaccination is not sufficient, you should get a antibody titer report. Only if you are a responder, then you should, you are permitted to work or handle the patient samples. If you are not a responder, then probably you should be given a work which does not deal with the biological samples. So that's all personal requirement. Moving on is, so what you are saying, you have in clause 4, you are saying that you have created a structure, a quality management system, you have documented your everything, you have created a quality management system, you are doing your you know what is the procedure for identification of vendors and monitoring vendors, referral laboratories, consultants, quality indicators, risks. After, so your foundation has become so solid, and now you are looking into the technical competence one by one. And once you have everything safe, you have the best of the staff, which has been very nicely trained, it is for sure it is taken consideration that your staff is not going to do mistakes and errors will automatically get minimized. Next is accommodation and environmental condition. What is so important about it? Because you're working in a laboratory, the equipment require certain temperatures to operate. All your reagents, consumables, like important ones, like controls, calibrators, they need to be maintained at appropriate temperatures. So you should be able to monitor your laboratory temperature, laboratory humidity, temperature of your refrigerators. So all these things have to be monitored, and this monitoring has to be very scrupulously done, because if it could so happen that your refrigerator is not working, you are keeping your kids in the refrigerator, you are not monitoring the temperature, suddenly one day you know that it, like certain tests are just showing out of range QCs, you don't understand what has gone wrong. After thorough root cause analysis, you understand the fridge where the kids were stored is not able to achieve the optimum temperature. So maintaining the temperature, accommodation and environmental conditions is very, very important. 5.3 deals with laboratory equipments, reagents and consumables. So all your equipments, whenever lab gets a new equipment, lab should have a procedure of procuring a new equipment. What is your requirement? What equipment you are going to choose? Once you get the equipment, and once you have new equipment in place, you should have all those three documents of installation qualification, operational qualifications, and performance qualification. You should have equipment in such a way that your equipment is able to give you, your equipment is able to give you results, desirable results. It should not be happening that, okay, I'm taking a simple test like blood glucose, but my equipment is not reporting it correctly. No, I have to do initial my validation studies so that my equipment is functioning to the best of its ability. All the equipments need to be calibrated. Records of all equipments should be maintained. All your reagents should be properly stored. Whenever you have a new reagent, then there has to be a record of reagent acceptance. What have I received? Whether I received the same what I have ordered, whether the quantity is same, whether it has come in the appropriate packing, whether the packing is same or it got distorted, whether the appropriate temperature conditions are maintained. Everything has to be documented on your acceptance of reagent. Not only acceptance of reagents, once you're going to put new reagents in place, you should carry out lot to lot. You should be doing your testing with earlier reagent lot, new reagent lot, and you should compare the results. And if the results are within the acceptable range, then and only then such reagent should be used for patient testing. So this clause deals with all lab equipment, reagent, reagent acceptance, lot to lot, and so on. 5.4 is pre-examination processes. It is before we do, it's all dealt with sample collection. So what are the requirements of in a sample collection room? Important one is that, yes, sample collection room, you should be able to maintain patient privacy. You should be able to maintain patient comfort, like whatever couch or bed which you're using, you should be comfortable for the patient. If you have a female patient, you should have appropriate curtain so that the privacy of the patient is maintained. When you're collecting the sample has to be stored appropriately at proper temperature conditions so that the sample does not get deteriorated. Whatever material that you use for collection has to be appropriately discarded as per the biomedical waste guidelines. So all these things come in pre-examination processes, and this usually forms the component of your sample collection manual. Then are examination processes. Examination processes are nothing but SOPs. All your test SOPs have to be documented in detail. You cannot have one SOP common to all reagents, especially in biochemistry, because we are using an autoanalyzer. I will have one SOP for all. No, it is not recommended. You will have to have separate SOP for all. And there was a session on SOP wherein things have been discussed in detail. So I will not go in detail about the examination processes, what all needs to be done. Ensuring quality of examination results, 5.6. This clause deals with internal quality control, external quality control. Yesterday we had a nice session on this. What is IQC? What is ECAS? What is lab defined mean? What are the LJs? Which waste guard rules are to be followed? And so on and so forth. What is external quality control? How do you get those results? What is standard deviation? not what is Z score or what is standard deviation index, what is target score, all these things you have to understand. Then and when then you will be able to interpret your IQC results, your ECAS results, and when there are outliers either in IQC or ECAS, then you will have to take appropriate corrective action. So ensuring qualitative examination result, this is the heart of every diagnostic laboratory, and this particular component has to be very, very rigidly monitored. Each and every lab should have its own IQC and ECAS protocol. There has to be a quality monitoring officer who is going to review your IQC and ECAS results on day-to-day basis, and it is very, very important. What I would like to advise you here is when you go for WestGuard rules for your internal quality, there are n number of rules, right, from warning rule of 1-2 years to so many outlier rules, either suggesting a random error or a systematic error. So it is not mandatory for the laboratory to follow all 1-2 years, 1-3 years, or 4 years, 2-2 years, 10x, 7x, train chip. No, lab can have its own policy, what all rules I have to follow. And once you decide that okay, I'm going to follow these four rules, then lab will have to follow these four rules. Yes, once these four rules are very nicely followed and they set in very well, then after a year or two, lab can review. Okay, you can add a few more rules and further enhance your quality systems. Post-examination procedures deals with what happens later once your sample analysis is done. So all samples, there are NABL guidelines, has to be retained for certain amount of time, like biochemistry minimum 24 hours, your all HPLC, like HbA1c 7 days, and so on and so forth. So there are fixed time limit which have been given. So how you are going to store and retain your samples, how you are going to report your results, what are the various report contents you will have, the entire report, what are the report contents you will have, what all would be the header, what would be the footer, what would be the body of the report would look like. You should be giving the name of the test, the methodology which has been practiced, the biological reference interval, and so on. And all this is under post-examination processes. This also deals with entire biomedical waste. 5.8 is reporting of results. 5.9 is release of results. Now there is difference between reporting of results and release of reports. Reporting of results is you are just reporting. What should be the report contain, the header, the footer, the body, what all should be captured, and all those things. Those form a report content or report attributes. Release of report basically deals with who is going to release the report and to whom. This is the crux. Release of report has to be done by an authorized signatory. Reporting of result can be done by the technical staff, but release of the report has to be done by an authorized signatory because he has gone through the result and then he is releasing the report. Or there can be a mechanism wherein he reviews the report and gives rights of release of report to someone else. But there has to be an authorized signatory who is going to monitor the entire report before it is released to the patients. And the last but not the least, gone are those days wherein we were working with colorimeters or semi-automated analyzers, and we were creating records on big registers. Today's labs have become more complex labs. The complexity has increased, the equipmentation has increased, the number of tests, the number of samples is on the rise. And unless and until you have entire digital support to it, you are not able to meet the challenges of today's laboratory. So yes, the laboratory information management, now it is just deals with information management. Information could be in the physical form, information could be in the digital form. So if you are having information, laboratory information means me, it takes care of everything. What samples you have received, what where your test requisition forms, the data that has been generated by the laboratory, the report that has been given to the patient, the samples which you have referred, reports of the referral laboratory, and so on. all this has to be a part of the laboratory information management. Lab should design a procedure for adapting or maintaining his laboratory information and monitoring that it is working effectively. But yes, today information management is more done in the digital format. So lab should have a proper laboratory information system. And if you have a digital laboratory information system, if you are using a software, bi-directional interfacing software, or if you are connected with hospital information management system, then these systems, electronic systems, should be validated. You should get a validation certificate from the manufacturer of those digital systems. And not only that, once you get validation, you should be able to carry out, or you should carry out periodically, 6 months or yearly, verification whether your information system or your entire hospital laboratory information system is working appropriately or not. So that was all I have taken you through, all those 25 clauses which forms the backbone of any clinical laboratory. And if you just go back now, and if you have everything fine, your personnel are good, your environmental conditions are well maintained, all your equipments are state of the art, their performance is guaranteed, reagents are, you get best quality of reagents, you ensure that they are stored appropriately, you have a very nice sample collection facility, and you get a good quality of, that's your input to the, for getting a result output. So you have good, able to collect a good quality of sample, your test procedures are appropriately validated and approved, then your quality control is in place and your post-examination processes are complete, then I'm sure you are able to generate the best of the report. There is no chance that your report is going to go wrong, and because of which there is a global equivalence, because somebody who are here in India or Sri Lanka or Nepal or somebody in the USA, Australia, New Zealand is going through the same system, and because which the end result is going to be the same. Another document which we'll just quickly go through, this is NABL 112 document. And this document has been created in line with ISO 15189-2012. But this speaks about the specific criteria for accreditation of medical. What additional specific criteria? There are certain additions or certain requirements which have been specified, and it defines the, for NABL accreditation purpose, what are the type of laboratory, what is micro size lab, what is small size lab, medium size, large or extra size laboratory. Then it has given what all things additionally one has to look for in 4.1 to 4.15, again in the technical requirement. So you will have to go. What is more interesting about this is it gives, the annexures are very, very, knowledge worthy, and you should go through this. There, guidelines for scope preparation, how will you prepare your lab scope? Guidelines for lot verification, when you're doing lot verification, how it is to be done, whether you'll do it with one sample, two sample, whether you want control to be put into it, what should be your acceptance criteria? What is the guidelines for order of drop so that you get a good quality of sample? What is proficiency testing and how to improve the quality of the laboratory by guidelines for this proficiency testing or external quality controls? And yes, there is an algorithm for automated selection and reporting of results. I, in my experience of last 10-12 years, I have not yet seen any laboratory who is using this algorithm. But if you go through this algorithm, it is so nicely planned that if you are able to follow this algorithm in toto, then 90% of the lab reports, especially from a referral lab, they need not be seen by authorized signatory. It can just be released to the patient as it is, because algorithm is so beautifully made. Whether the QC was run, what are the QC, whether it was value was within 2 SD, whether it was between 2 to 3 SD. So everything has been planned so well. But to my knowledge, I have not seen anybody using this algorithm. But yes, any big laboratory can take up this challenge and start implementing the algorithm for automated selection and reporting of results. There are various other NABL documents which you'll get on NABL website. I will not go into details about it. So this is the NABL website, and whatever documents you want, once you log into this website, go to the publication tab, and under publication tab you will get documents. Click on those documents and you will get the entire list of documents. All the documents are freely downloadable. Only ISO 15189-2012, that's a paid document. Rest all other documents are free of charge. Having understood this, I don't think it is sufficient. And if somebody wants to really go for the process of accreditation, I would recommend that there are a lot of many internal auditors training courses are done, wherein all these clauses are dealt in detail, word by word, para by para. So please undergo internal auditors training course as per ISO 15189-2012. And it is a must requirement for quality manager. If you are planning to be a quality manager or if you are appointed as a quality manager, you should undergo this 4 days internal auditor training course. Who is authorized to train? There are so many agencies which train, and there is nothing from NABL. I want to make it clear. There is nothing from NABL that only this agency or you have to be accredited, nothing like that. Anybody who is trained into ISO 15189-2012 can conduct training on internal auditors training. So documents and records, I already discussed these things in detail. I will not go in details. So what is the level of documentation that you need to have before you go for accreditation? And usually we discuss it under as 3 or 4 levels of documents. The quality manual, quality system procedures, SOPs, instructions, forms, formats, and records. So if I go by this pyramid, the quality manual is the apex document of the lab. And what is a quality manual? Quality manual, if you see, is nothing but ISO 15189. All these clauses which I have discussed right now, they are put in your quality manual. Only thing is that the language that has been put in the quality manual is based on the language of the laboratory. The quality manual will say that lab should have a documented procedure for so and so. Quality manual will say the lab has a documented procedure. So whatever lab's broad policies with respect to ISO 15189-2012, all are documented in quality manual. Then is the quality system procedures. What is the difference between this? People have a lot of confusion between quality system procedures and standard operating procedures. Both are procedures. Quality system procedures are procedures for how the lab performs quality system activities. What are quality system activities? Vendor evaluation, referral lab evaluation, monitoring of quality indicators. So all these things become a quality system procedure related. Risk management procedure, risk assessment procedure, procedure for internal audit. So all these are related to quality system activities, and these procedures are called as quality system procedures, whereas SOPs are step-by-step instructions for testing activity. So please remember, QSP is a non-testing activity and SOP is for a testing activity. The structure could be nearly the same, not exactly the same. There could be few things which will be same in QSP and SOP. SOP is more detailed, more step-by-step, more points to be covered, but SOP is for a testing activity and QSP is for a not. In QSP, you can have what is your purpose of the QSP, who are the persons responsible for the QSP. Then you can say what are the steps by which the QSP to be followed, to be done, and what are the documents and records to be maintained for that QSP. But SOP is much, it comes principal, biological reference interval, your interfering factors, quality control, and so on and so forth. Now, once you understood the quality manual, quality system procedures, SOPs, there's something called as forms and formats. So what is a form or what is a format? If you have something which is separate, which you can either download or you can take a print, or which is readily available, you can fill it immediately, that becomes a form. That form will have the header, the footer, the various headings. Say, for example, I want to have a form for monitoring the temperature data. So it will contain all the things, and on that I'll be utilizing that form daily to monitor my lab temperature or refrigerator temperature. What is the format then? It is a skeleton given. So how do you implement that skeleton is up to the laboratory, is to the end users. Like I can have a skeleton, this is my format. So my QSP will document, I'm going to document, record this in the following format. Then I will take a register, I will make those columns in the register, and I'll use the same format for documenting my records. So that's a subtle difference between forms and records. What is different between form formats and records? So when you have a QSP or when you have a SOP, these are nothing but procedures. And when you are going to follow these procedures, you are going to get some data. If you are going to do a vendor evaluation, then you will have to have some structured way by vendor evaluation has to be done. So you will create a form for vendor evaluation. It cannot be a format. If I want to have a temperature records, I can create a format and I can use that format. But if I want to do vendor evaluation, there are n number of things which I have to see. So I'll create a form for vendor evaluation. But that's a blank form. And then I'll carry out my vendor evaluation. The moment I carry out vendor evaluation and I fill in this form becomes a record. Understood? So my record gets created, and for creating my record, I need a form or I need a format. I want to keep a record of refrigerator temperature. So I'm using a register wherein I have a format. I'm using that format. I'm capturing the data on that format, on that register. So that register automatically becomes my record. So these are the levels of documentation. It is usually said that quality manual is the apex document, level one document. Quality system procedures and SOP become your level two documents, and formats and records become your level three documents. I'll just tell you, please, no background noise, please. I'll just tell you how do we connect all these documents in one go. Say, for example, in my quality manual, clause number 5.3.1.1, the actual clause is, the lab shall have a documented procedure for the selection, purchasing, and management of equipment. So that's the clause. How will I document this in my quality manual? I'll write it as the laboratory has a, here laboratory shall have. So here you can say the laboratory, or even I will write my name of the laboratory. The dash laboratory has a documented procedure for selection, purchasing, and management of equipment. So that comes in my quality manual. Now, if I want to say that it has a documented procedure, so I'll have to create a procedure. So what would be the procedure? The procedure is for selection, purchase, and management of equipment. It's a non-technical procedure. So we call this as a quality system procedure. So I'll create a procedure, quality system procedure for selection, purchasing, and management of equipment. Now, when I create a quality system procedure for selection, purchase, and management of equipment, I'll have a procedure, I'll implement that procedure in buying an equipment, and I'll have the equipment. So what records will get created? I will have a record of equipment purchase. So it will have installation qualification, operational qualification, performance qualification, the various tender records. So I will have all records. So try to understand how the system evolves. This is the clause in the ISO 15189. This is the clause which I'm documenting in my quality manual. Based on this clause, I'm preparing a quality system procedure. For once I prepare a quality system procedure, I am automatically creating the record. Once I create this quality system, say for example, I'm buying an auto analyzer. Then I will also have to have a procedure for daily maintenance, daily, weekly, monthly maintenance. So I will have a procedure for maintenance of the equipment. And those maintenance will have maintenance log sheets. So those blank log sheets or blank forms, once I fill up those forms, automatically they will become a form of my equipment records. So that's how the entire flow goes. So steps to create your own documents and record: prepare your quality manual. NABL 160 will guide you on how to prepare a quality manual. For each clause, identify the documented procedure. Whether you require a QSP or SOP, document those QSPs and SOPs. For each procedure, prepare. From that procedure, you will have to capture the data. To capture that data, you will either require forms or logs or format. So prepare them. And once you feed in those, they will get converted into your records. Now, once you are done with this, you have a quality manual, QSPs, SOPs, all forms, records in plus. What is the minimum requirement before you apply to an ABL? Yes, all documents and records has to be in place, updated. All equipments need to be calibrated as per NABL 112 guidelines. All tests under scope should be covered in ICAS or interlab comparison. You cannot have a test which is not covered under ICAS and ILC. You have to have all tests under ICAS and ILC. Minimum one report should be there. Lab should have conducted one internal audit. You can refer to NABL 161 and 217 checklist, how to conduct internal audit. And after the internal audit, lab should have conducted one management review meeting, and all observations of MRM need to be closed. All instances of the internal audit have to be closed. Then the lab is ready to go for NABL accreditation. There are some people say that lab should have 6 months ICAS before they go for accreditation. No, the guidelines are very, very simple. Lab should participate in at least one PT program or ICWA prior to getting accreditation in each discipline. So biochemistry, pathology, hematology, so each discipline there. That means each and every test should have undergone at least one PT program. It is expected that at least all major analytes of the scope are covered under PT participation. That is important. What sometimes it's happen, you participate and you fail in your PT performance. What? Participation in PT program with Z score less than 2 or an outlier will be considered as satisfactory participation. Please remember, even if the Z score is less than 2, it's satisfactory. But if it goes beyond 2, it will also be acceptable if the lab has taken necessary corrective action based on the root cause analysis. So no panic, your QC, IQC results are the ICAS is outlier. Do a proper root cause analysis, take a proper corrective action, and with that corrective action, apply for NABL. How to apply for NABL? Nowadays, everything is on NABL portal. So NABL WP stands for web portal, nablewpqci.org.in. Log on to this site, click on to register. This is the initial window. Then you have to register yourself. Once you register, this is the registration desk you will get. Name of the lab, type, name, what type, name, all these details you will have to fill in. You will have to put in one mobile number, which will be a permanent number, which will be attached to the NABL, on which you will get OTPs. And once you are registered, then you apply for pre-assessment or final assessment. Earlier, pre-assessment was a compulsory thing, but nowadays they have removed pre-assessment. It's no more a compulsory thing. We can directly go for the final assessment. Fill online application with necessary documentary evidence. Application will undergo scrutiny. The quality manual one which you submit will undergo whether it's adequate or not. So you will get a quality manual adequacy report. So both quality manual and application will go repeated scrutinies. There will be continuous interaction between the lab and the NABL. Whatever has been asked by the NABL, lab has to rectify it. Once both these things are approved, then NABL gives a date for pre-assessment or final assessment. This is the entire procedure. I will not go in details about this, what the procedure is. And yes, once you have NABL assessment, once you are able to close all the NCs which have been raised, successfully NCs are closed in the stipulated period, this is what you get. This is what the lab, everyone is eager to get. The certificate of accreditation, you get certificate of accreditation, you get a typical certificate number. That certificate number should be used on your test report. NABL logo and a certificate number, these two combined is called as a NABL symbol. There is a difference between NABL logo and NABL symbol. Only logo is NABL logo. Logo along with certificate number is NABL symbol. It will also give you the entire scope of accreditation. What is the scope to which the lab is accredited? So what does it mean? Lab meets all criteria as per ISO 15189 and 2012 standards. It gives an assurance to the client that the procedures and test results are technically valid. The lab staff is technically competent. endorses that the lab has effective quality management system. But please remember, accreditation is for the test. Under the scope of accreditation, whatever is not under scope of accreditation, NABL has nothing to do with it, and it is location specific. Say, for example, one laboratory has got 5 branches in the city or in the country. There could be one lab accredited, rest may not be accredited. So accreditation is location specific. When I used to take these lectures early on, when I became NABL assessor 10, 12 years back, and there were very few of us as NABL assessors. So this was a constant question asked to me by whenever I used to deliver such lectures. So how to become an NABL assessor? This is an old slide. There is no more advertisement now. There is a tab on NABL website under training. And under training, there is an assessor's training. So you have to put in your biodata onto that tab, fill in your details and give your biodata. What is required? You require a good laboratory experience is required. Nowadays, they ask minimum 5 years. And I think they have put up an age limit also 42 or 43. Which is, I feel personally bad, because youngsters can also become assessors. There is nothing wrong in it if they have adequate experience. And then, what you really have to have a good biodata, good laboratory experience, and depending on the need of NABL, they will shortlist, and then they will give you a 5 days residential training at your cost. And then initially they will put you as an observer, wherein you will observe one assessment, one live assessment, and after that you get as a technical assessor for either your specialty. Once you have enough experience of technical assessor, you become lead assessor, and then with further experience you become member of technical or expert committee member to NABL. So for further details, please log on to NABL website, and I also advise you to check the site for Labs for Life. This is one website which is an NGO, basically Labs for Life. But this NGO has designed so many modules, training modules, videos, documents, PPTs, and which cover all the aspects of ISO. So please visit this site, Labs for Life, labsforlife.in. And you will have plenty of information. Just go through. Some are good, some are not so good, but you can really pick up what you want. Training module on quality control, equipment management, documentation. So you'll get n number of things on this. So apart from NABL, you please visit this site also. And with this, I conclude my talk. And although I didn't time it, but I think I was well in time. And once again, thank you all for patient listening. And thank you, organizer Dr. Anita Kale Madam, Robert, entire team of KEM Biochemistry, who has organized this wonderful CME. Thank you. Thanks a lot.